Good morning, UPC. It has been, I don't even know what to call this week. So let's just dive into our call to worship today. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. We will not fear when the earth changes, when the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, when its waters roar and foam, when the mountains tremble. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God. God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be moved. God will help it when morning dawns. Our nation is in uproar. The kingdom has faltered, but the Lord utters his voice and the earth melts. The Lord is with us. Come and worship our God of refuge. Lord God, you are our refuge and our strength. So we pray that in this time of trouble, God, though mountains are shaking, that the seas are roaring, God, that we know that you are with us. Today, may we be still and feel your presence. May we be filled with hope and peace in the promise of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus, the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, no, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
And God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time, no point of reference, you spoke to the dark, fleshed out the wonder of life. see your heart in everything you've done. Every part designed in a work of art called love. If you gladly chose to surrender so alive, I could see your heart 8 billion different ways. Every precious one, the child you died to. If you gave your life to love them so loud, like you would again 100 billion times. But what measure could amount to your desire? You're the one.
As followers of Jesus, coming to God in confession is honestly one of the most important things we can do, to recognize that we can't do this thing alone, that we are in need of grace and we need to be people that extend grace. And so let us join together in our confession this morning. Lord God, we come before you today in desperate need of grace. The country's suffering, Lord. We have sowed seeds that have not fallen on good soil. We have picked up swords instead of crosses. We've made enemies out of brothers and sisters. We've approached the world with closed fists rather than open hands. We have failed to walk the way of the cross. Revenge has become our new normal. Lord, we focus our minds and hearts on you so that we may see you in every person, and that every person may see you in us. Amen. The Apostle Paul says that in Jesus Christ, the old is gone and the new has come. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. So thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
And how deep Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many ones to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulder, the my mocking voice loud among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer.
This past Wednesday, we witnessed one of the more haunting scenes in our history. As Congress gathered together at the Capitol to confirm the electoral votes from November, rioters stormed the building, overrunning police barricades and ascending walls, breaking windows, chasing elected officials out of the chambers. And at first I was mostly in shock as I watched the events unfold. But then the initial shock turned into a deep ache, an overwhelming sorrow that I haven't been able to quite shake yet. And it wasn't because of broken windows or doors or even vandalizing monuments or stealing podiums. Buildings, at the end of the day, are only buildings, infrastructure that can be replaced. What was most troubling for me as a pastor, especially thinking about the state of this country and how we've been living amongst one another, was that on the same day that a black man and a Jewish man were elected in Georgia, Confederate flags were marched through the hall of the Capitol. And some of the rioters were caught in video wearing Nazi propaganda. And right outside, a noose was assembled. There was a message, and it was received. You know, I've seen people arguing about the violence on both sides and pointing fingers at one another, trying to compare it to other events over the past year. But it isn't the physical damage done that I think should trouble us the most. Rather, the message that those symbols delivered, nooses, Confederate flags, and Nazism. How do we walk the path of the cross in the presence of the gallows? There is a sickness in our country, a disease of racism that we need to repent of. And this disease is killing our collective soul. We need healing. We need resurrection. There's a story in the book of Mark. It takes place right after Jesus liberates a person who is possessed by demons. Scripture says that Jesus got into the boat again and went back to the other side of the lake, where a large crowd gathered around him on the shore. Then a leader of the local synagogue, whose name was Jairus, arrived. When he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet, pleading fervently with him. "My little daughter's dying," he said. "Please come and lay your hands on her. Heal her so she can live." Jesus went with him, and all the people followed, crowding around him. A woman in the crowd had suffered for 12 years with constant bleeding. She had suffered a great deal from many doctors, and over the years she had spent everything she had to pay them, but she had gotten no better. In fact, she'd gotten worse. She had heard about Jesus, so she came up behind him through the crowd and touched his robe. For she thought to herself, "If I can just touch his robe, I will be healed." And immediately the bleeding stopped, and she could feel in her body that she had been healed of her terrible condition. Jesus realized at once that healing power had gone out of him, so he turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my robe?" His disciples said to him, "Look at this crowd pressing in around you. How can you ask, 'Who touched me?'" But he kept on looking around to see who had done it. Then the frightened woman, trembling at the realization of what had happened to her, came and fell to her knees in front of him and told him what she had done. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace, your suffering, it's over." While she was still speaking to her, messengers arrived from the home of Jairus, the leader of the synagogue, and they told him, "Your daughter is dead. There's no use troubling the teacher now." But Jesus overheard them and said to Jairus, "Don't be afraid, just have faith." Then Jesus stopped the crowd and wouldn't let anyone go with him except Peter, James, and John. When they came to the home of the synagogue leader, Jesus saw much commotion and weeping and wailing, and he went inside and asked, "Why all this commotion and weeping? The child isn't dead. She's just asleep." The crowd laughed at him, but he made them all leave, and he took the girl's father and mother and his three disciples into the room where the girl was lying. Holding her hand, he said to her, little girl, get up. And the girl, who was 12 years old, immediately stood up and walked around. They were overwhelmed and totally amazed, and Jesus gave them strict orders not to tell anyone what had happened. And then he told them to give her something to eat. There's a theme that runs throughout the book of Mark. Don't tell anyone what you've seen. Now, as readers, Mark reveals in the very first verse that this is, in fact, the good news about Jesus, the Messiah. It is a secret Mark lets us in on, but one that Jesus constantly keeps quiet. It isn't until much later in the gospel narrative that we finally get to Peter's declaration that Jesus is Lord, which makes today's story all the more interesting. As the crowd is pressing in on Jesus, a man named Jairus approaches him. And Jairus is the leader of the synagogue. This would mean that Jairus was primarily responsible for arranging and conducting worship. He helped lead people into worship. And when he gets to Jesus, we're told the first thing he does is fall down at his feet. Now, often when people beg, they get on their knees, and that's a common expression of begging. But the fact that Mark, who isn't known for much detail, explicitly tells us that Jairus is the leader of the synagogue leads me to believe there's a little more to it. Because the position of begging, it's also a position of worship. Before Jesus has done anything for him, Jairus comes and kneels before Jesus. He pleads to Jesus. He prays to Jesus to heal his daughter. In the midst of a disorderly and lively crowd, Jairus has an awareness about Jesus, an awareness that this is someone who might just be worthy of worship. And so then Jesus goes with him. And while they're on the way to heal Jairus' daughter, we are interrupted by another story. And it's something that Mark does often, basically sandwiching another story in between. So there's this woman who's very sick and she's dying. So sick, in fact, that the physicians have only made things worse for her. And so Mark wants us to know very clearly, no one else can heal this woman. She's been sick for 12 years. That's a long time. This is it for her. But then something happens. She reaches for Jesus, and immediately she's healed. Knowing what happened to her, we're told she's so overcome by fear and trembling that, like Jairus, she falls to Jesus' feet. Not because she's scared of him finding out that she was the one who touched him, but because she is in awe of what he had just done for her. In response to the miracle, she too takes on a posture of worship. And while all this is going on, we catch word that Jairus' daughter has died. Jesus didn't get there in time. The Bible says that hearing this, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, and here's Mark again highlighting that detail. Jesus says to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, just have faith." Then Jesus took the father, as well as Peter, James, and John with him. Remember, Jesus likes to keep things small. Jesus likes being on the down low. So upon arriving at the house, Jesus is met with a very different crowd. The first crowd was intrigued by him, maybe amazed or even curious. They pressed into him. That's what Mark keeps saying. They keep pressing in to Jesus. But the crowd at the house was more skeptical. They laugh at him. But Jesus is undeterred. And scripture says that he takes the girl's hand. He reaches for her. And he says to her, "Little girl, get up." And she does. And at this, the skeptical mocking crowd is overcome with amazement. And Jesus tells them not to say anything about it. This story, it's all about healing. And in this story alone, we see multiple kinds of healing, multiple paths to healing. It's a process. In this story, Jairus plays the role of the advocate. His prayers are intercessory for his daughter. He wants his daughter to survive, so he chooses to go to Jesus for her because she can't fight this battle alone. He surrenders himself to Christ and falls before his feet. In light of everything that we've experienced this week, over the past year, for a long time, if we want this country to heal, to move forward, then we need to be advocates for the suffering and lift up the voices of those who aren't being heard. If we want unity and peace, then we need to come before Jesus on behalf of those who are hurting, who are oppressed, who are in great need. To do this is an act of worship to the Lord. And we can pray for our country the way Jairus prays for his daughter. Lord, this nation is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her that she may be made well and live. Healing, at least in this story, it begins with advocacy. But it's just a start because we are also like the woman in the story. We have sins that plague us, old habits, biases, prejudices that can be difficult to rid ourselves from. But Jesus wants to heal us. Jesus can heal us. It doesn't matter if these sins have plagued us for 5 years or 10 or an entire lifetime. Jesus can heal anyone. But we need to be willing to reach for Jesus. We can't just assume that we're good to go. We can't allow ourselves to be comfortable in our sin. We need to be self-aware, to come before Christ in confession and allow us, him to make us well, to be willing to reach out and touch his robes. But beyond both the prayers, we need to be active. Jairus prays for his daughter, and the woman reaches for Jesus to heal her. But prayer needs to be followed by action. This nation, it's not going to heal if we remain complacent. We will never see progress if we aren't willing to follow Jesus to the places where the broken and the hurting dwell. We can pray for others, and it is so important. We can reach for Jesus in our personal life, and that is also so important. But we need to be willing to go with Jesus to the dead places, to the broken places. Peter, James, and John, they go with Jesus to see the girl who died. And they take part in the resurrection story. Praying for healing, it is so essential to the life of faith. But we also need to make healing happen. When Jesus beckons us to follow him toward the dying, the suffering, the oppressed, are we willing to go? Are we willing to carry the cross in the presence of the gallows? Are we willing to raise the cross higher than flags of hate and division? No one is too far gone for Jesus. No country is too far gone. Nothing is lost to God. It's something I firmly believe, that Jesus is in the business of redemption, and there is no one, no thing, no place that is irredeemable to Jesus. Friends, this was a really hard week. And words, they fall short. There's nothing I can say to sum up what we experienced. But in spite of all of it, I believe that Jesus heals. We need only to follow his voice as he beckons us to come and see, as he invites us to be healers in the presence of death, to be peacemakers in the presence of war, to be kingdom builders in the presence of ruin. Healing, it's waiting. We just need to reach for it. Let us pray. Lord God, you are a healer. You You are a redeemer. You are a reconciler. And God, we need you to heal, to redeem, and to reconcile this land, this place we call home, God. There is a lot of sorrow, a lot of hatred, a lot of division, a lot of finger pointing, God. But in the midst of it all, you are Lord. And so we come to you asking that you will instill in us a sense of grace, that we will be peacemakers, that we will share the love of Jesus to those who are hurting and to those that hurt us, God. May we be a people who build up the kingdom rather than destroy. Lord God, we ask all this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, our Redeemer, our Healer. Amen. Friends, now to the only one who's able to keep you from falling, to the only God, our Savior, through our Lord Jesus Christ, be all glory, all power, all majesty, both now and forevermore. Amen.